right through the storm, felt the wind upon my face, and all the while I could not help but see the life that lives and breathes in you and me, and I am peaceful, and I am grateful, and I'm thankful. And saw a shooting star above. I looked into your eyes and touched an open heart and fell into a whole lot of love. And all the while I could not help but see the life that lives and breathes.
Good morning and welcome to Center for Spiritual Living, Greater Las Vegas. During this time, before the Sunday celebration, we encourage you to let this music take you to a deeper place and allow yourself to be open and receptive to this morning's message. Thank you.
Yeah. It's getting more and more intricate. That is a piece called Namaste, written by Darren, our guest this morning, and performed by them. Awesome. Good morning. Welcome to Center for Spiritual Living, Greater Las Vegas, where we believe it is always a perfect day, and we happen to be in a part of the county called Paradise, so it's a perfect day in Paradise. What do you think of that? That's an amazing thing. We believe that God is all there is, that you are a creation of that one, whatever you call. I just call it God because it's easier. For me, it's three letters. I can remember it usually. So, but it goes, whatever you want to call that intelligence that created the universe, this is everything that is. And that includes you and me and us together. And we are awakening to that. We are working together to create a world that works for everyone. So if you are here for the very first time, we absolutely embrace you this morning as a perfect creation of God. Why are you laughing at me? Now I'm all thrown. I've got hecklers. I got hecklers for the first time in a while. This is awesome. Anyway, if you are here for the very first time, we love that you came here this morning. Whatever it is that brought you here, I believe it was some incarnation of that creator to allow you to keep awakening to the truth of who you are. There's a connection card that you were given as part of the packet when you came in. Everybody has one. I would love it if you would all fill that out with at least the date and your name. If you're here for the very first time, let us know about you, how you found us, who you are, that you're here for the first time. We can find ways to stay connected with you if that works for you, and maybe you'll come back. If you're back a second time, thank you for that. It's great, and we hope that something has ignited you to become a part of this community on a regular basis. Those of you who are here regularly, it's wonderful to see you again. It would not be the same without you. If you're joining us online, live, or via our archives, welcome, because God is present where you are now. We know this to be the truth always, so we're grateful for that. So we believe that affirmative living and affirmative thinking and speaking is a really wonderful creative process to bring the life of our dreams into our reality. So please say after me, praise God, it's a perfect day.
Praise God, it's a perfect day.
I am so glad to be here.
Life is good.
And so it is. You know, we say, and so it is, that's our form of amen. I don't know why I was spell checking the notes that I had written on my computer for today, and the word program wanted to change it to, and so, comma, it is. And I thought, well, that works okay too. So say after me, and so it is. See, it works. It's all good. Anyway, we love to sing here. The words that we sing together as a congregation will be on the screen. We're going to do that now. So if and as you are able, will you please stand? Our singing team's going to join me on stage, and we're going to sing, I am blessed because I am. Four.
I have four.
Now we're together. Here we go.
Here we go.
I am blessed. I am blessed. Blessed. When I wake up in the morning or lay my head to rest, I am blessed. I am blessed.
I am loved.
I am loved. I am loved. Every day of my life, I am loved, 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 loved. When I wake up in the morning or lay my head to rest, I am in the morning or lay my head to rest, I am blessed. I am blessed.
I am blessed.
I am blessed. I am blessed.
One more.
I am blessed. I am blessed.
Share that. that blessing with each other. Walk around, shake a hand, get a hug. If you don't know the person, introduce yourself.
As we move into this morning's contemplation time, please take a moment to check in on Facebook and then silence your cell phones. Thank you. Let's begin this week's affirmation from your program. You might choose to cut it out and read it aloud often this week to remind you of the truth of your being. Today and for all time, I let my years of learning and loving life enrich every moment with wisdom. I am a wise old soul. Take in a deep breath and let this music carry you into a minute of silence, after which I'll do an invocation.
As I say a tender yes to everything that comes to me, my heart is open, I am free. I open to all that is, it brings me to my knees. I surrender, I am peace. As I say a tender yes to everything that comes to me, my heart is open, I am free. Surrender, I am peace.
there is only one here, one infinite presence, one power. And that is what I call God. A single creative mind, manifesting always love, joy, and peace. And it is this creative mind and divine action that have brought us together here today. One community, many faces, much love, still the one presence of God. And it is in this moment we celebrate community, each other, our differences, our similarities. We are a celebration. We are a center for spiritual living. And it is in this peaceful moment that I am open and receptive to receive the blessings of the spoken words today and to feel and embrace the harmony of the musical gifts. It is also in this moment I am filled with gratitude. Gratitude for those present, for this community, for this Center for Spiritual Living, for all that is unfolding perfectly in this moment. And it is with gratitude and great thanksgiving that I invite you to open this celebration with me today by saying together, and so it is.
Right.
The name of that?
It's called
Lonely Hearts at Sea. Lonely Hearts at Sea. Is that yours?
Yeah.
It's beautiful, Darren. Beautiful. Thank you. Thanks, guys. That was awesome. I feel very atmospheric now. It's very meditative. Oh, this is our theme for March, which is awesome. Spiritual living through the principles, the values that we hold as an organization and as individuals in spiritual community together. Education and continuous improvement for our entire lives. And so the title this morning, Aging as a Spiritual Practice, is quite relevant if we want to spend our entire life improving continually. And so, is anyone aging in here? I know, well, I'll say we're not. Yeah. So before I get into the heart of the message this morning, I want to take a little survey of who's listening, or who's here anyway, even if you're not listening. And if you're watching online, play along as well. Is there anybody present now between the ages of 0 and 9? Logan, are you here? I don't think I saw him today. Okay, how about between the ages of 10 and 19? Anyone? She's like, you're not alone. You might be in the moment in this room, but you know. We love you. Okay, great. One there. How about in their 20s? Anyone here in their 20s? Awesome. Welcome. Anyone here in their 30s? Tell the truth. Great. That's good to hear. I notice all of the younger ones are way back. They're afraid. Be very afraid. Who here is in their 40s? Proud. Hands raised in their 40s. Who here is in their 50s? My people. Who's in their 60s? Wow! We're representing the 60s today. Who here is in their 70s? 70s are representing here today too. That's awesome. Who here is in their 80s? All right! Yeah! Who here is in their 90s? Look at that! And you notice they're sitting back with the youngest ones? There's something to that, I think. Is anybody here 100 or older? Does anyone feel 100 or older? No, I'm just kidding. That is awesome diversity already. And it tells me something, that because you are here sitting or standing and listening or not, but you're here, it tells me that at least in some measure, you are using your very natural physical process of, let's call it maturation, as a part of your spiritual practice. It's going hand in hand. But what I want to do this morning is kind of elevate that idea to our conscious mind, because maybe we haven't put the two together in a conscious way before. So first of all, I want to explore what is spiritual practice. And of all places, I found a perfectly focused definition in Wikipedia this week, and I thought it was pretty cool. It says, a spiritual practice is the regular or full-time performance of actions and activities undertaken for the purpose of inducing spiritual experiences and cultivating spiritual development. A practice to undertake those things consciously, spiritual experiences, and to work on cultivating our spiritual development. A common metaphor used in spiritual traditions of the world's religions is that of walking a path. Therefore, a spiritual practice moves a person along a path towards a goal. The goal is variously referred to as salvation, liberation, or union with God. A person who walks such a path is sometimes referred to as a wayfarer or a pilgrim. I like that definition for a lot of reasons, not the least of which is union with God, which is our mission here at this Center for Spiritual Living, inspiring conscious union with God. But most especially because it likens spiritual practice to walking a path. And that is very, very healthy, both physically and spiritually, to do those things, sometimes even together. And you can discover more of God as you're walking the path. One of those ways to do it is like walking a labyrinth. One of our Gourmets for God events is this afternoon out at Red Rock, and they're going to be walking a labyrinth. That is a spiritual practice that involves walking. So I love that definition in its entirety, because it's this idea of entering into something for the purpose of inducing spiritual experiences and cultivating spiritual development. And so long as I am looking at aging, or some of you might call it growing up, and some of us don't want to do that, but so long as I'm looking at that as a spiritual experience this morning, I think it would be wise and good to partner it, to marry it with another attribute of God, and that is grace. Do any of you know someone in your life older than yourself who you perceive as aging with grace? Yeah, there are millions of examples in this congregation. The longer I am here, the less there are older than me people, which is weird because I was like a child when I got here and everybody was older than me. Not anymore, but there are so many examples in this community, in this congregation, and in my life outside of this community. There are so many examples of that. And I think that it must be, at least in part, especially the people who are a part of a community like this, it's because we see all of life as a spiritual experience. And if we do, then the aging process, the very natural physical aging process, becomes a part of that spiritual experience. And I would like to emulate that as I grow older. And if you would too, here's the key: to age with grace, live as grace. Now, for me, up until recently, I've had kind of a challenge with the concept of grace being in this faith, because I had a very traditional paradigm understanding of what grace is. You know, often it is defined as the unmerited or undeserved love and goodness and givingness of God. Yuck. Undeserved. I don't deserve God's goodness. And so I had that idea, and so the idea of grace was sort of like, well, there's got to be a different way of understanding it. In the New Thought and in the Science of Mind tradition, and so I found Carolyn Mace. If you've ever read her, she is a thinker that goes places I can't even follow. But she's very broad-based in her understanding of spirit and nature and the universe and how it works. And she said that grace is energy infused with a force greater than our own, a divine intention. When it arrives out of the blue, it fills you with a luminous awareness that is different from everyday consciousness. Grace illuminates your path by moving through your intuition, influencing the choices that you make. It is a power that works hand in hand with intuition to guide our actions in the right direction that will do the most good. So it is an energy that is everywhere present, otherwise it couldn't show up out of the blue for us, but it works hand in hand with our intuition to guide us into greater and greater good that's always for our highest and best. And then I was exploring more the idea of grace, and I read a Christian theologian who called grace the activity of God in the human heart. It was a much broader concept of grace as well. So that helps me. That helps me to understand grace in a way that works for my understanding of the universe, that it is a part of the energy of God. It is the energy that is God, but it's moving through us in a greater way because it's paired with intuition, which is already the voice of God in us, our higher knowing. And so it is that. And what how we access it or how we make ourselves available to it is just by that. I am open and available. I am open for grace to be my experience. I am open to walking this path consciously, and I can set an intention then to live as this quality of God, to live as grace, this divine intention and luminous awareness as I walk the path of aging consciously. So this notion of aging as a spiritual practice, I wonder if there's anybody listening who has something else going on inside of them, something that says in words like this, now just wait a minute. You don't live with the conditions I do. It is impossible for me to see this as a spiritual practice. I cannot see this process of aging as it is happening for me to be anything other than difficult. I invite you to be open, just open to the possibility that even you, as with that kind of definition of your experience, that even someone in that condition can have an elevated experience. One of the wisest and most radiant practitioners, licensed practitioners of this teaching that I have ever had the privilege of knowing was early on in my time in this faith in Huntington Beach, in the church I was originally a part of. And her physical body was completely deformed by rheumatoid arthritis. I have never seen such a condition in my life. And I can't even imagine the levels of constant pain that she must have lived with. And yet all anyone ever felt in her presence was light and love and wisdom. It was the most profound experience I have ever had to be seeing something with my physical eyes and to feel something that didn't match that at all. And I thought, if she could live that way, then I can live that way. That instead of choosing to focus on things that don't work the way they should, or tell me if you've thought this before, don't work the way they used to, that instead of doing that, I can use my physical process, I can use this idea of aging as a way to find a more conscious union with God. Now, for the last 4 years, I've been working out pretty much about 5 days a week. And so I am probably have the best physical fitness that I've ever had in my life. And yet, I notice that my wrists hurt when I'm doing plank work. And there's a tendon right here in my thumb that hurts when I'm using dumbbells and things like that. I could choose to focus on that and say, I'm falling apart. This is the aging process. My body doesn't work the way it used to. It doesn't work the way it should. Or I can choose instead to celebrate the miracle that is this body and the freedom that it allows me to go further into my deep dive into God and take my energy off of those things that hurt or that don't function the way I wish they did. It is a matter of choosing, oftentimes, a different outlook. And that's a small, in my mind, that's a small thing compared to the practitioner that I mentioned a while ago, that she transcended that. I have no idea what her private experience was. She never shared that. But what she was, who she was around everybody that I knew, was this radiant being who had there was no connection to the physical from what we could feel from her spiritually. That is an amazing thing to experience. So we all know, and it's very easy to see this in the physical state of our lives, it is done as we believe. It is done as we believe. And at some point, it doesn't really matter which came first, the condition or my awareness of believing it, believing that is my condition. At some point, it doesn't really matter because the very heart of our teaching, after God is all there is that it is done as we believe. I found this great graphic that goes with an Ernest Holmes quote. He said, life is a mirror and will reflect back to the thinker what he thinks into it. I don't know if you can see it. It's not very bright, but there's a chess piece, a pawn, standing in front of the mirror, and what's being reflected back? The king, right? So life is a mirror and will reflect back to the thinker what he or she thinks into it. And so our job is to take hold of this, no matter where we are in our journey through this physical incarnation as a human being, and use that mind as we've been given. It is an amazing thing that we have been given, and we can choose. We can choose what we think. We can choose what we see. We can choose to age creatively and gracefully and with greater expression the more we know that mind responds to mind. The mind that surrounds and indwells me responds to the thoughts that I am thinking into it. Now, this has been variously attributed to lots of different people, but as far as all the most current research can tell, it was published around the same time by multiple newspapers back in 1968. So it came from some anonymous government researcher who said, aging is a matter of mind. If you don't mind, it doesn't matter. Right? And you've heard that it was Satchel Paige or George Burns or some of the others. It's like, but this is so true. We believe that to be true. That mind is what makes our world. So I've got some action steps for you. Get it? You're walking a path. You're going to take some steps, right? So first, walk the path. Set your intention to use what is, to use the process of your life, the natural aging process, as a way to develop spiritually. That is a spiritual practice, a way to develop spiritually. And second, physically walk. You'll get healthier. And you might discover more of God along the way. So there's two benefits. There would be a physical and a spiritual benefit along the way. Third, take a class. You might think we talk about this too much, but this was formed as a teaching order. So we have people in our classes from the teenage years on up into their 90s, and it is amazing because those kinds of things allow us to keep our minds and our brains supple and growing and elastic. And Laura will get up in a little while to talk some more about the classes that are coming up, but this is a prime opportunity that we offer year-round in order to use that process as a spiritual practice. And the fourth one might sound interesting to you, but find the humor in aging. Some of you already have. And I don't know about you, but sometimes it seems like aging is a cruel joke that the universe is playing on us. But the truth of the matter is, sometimes it is just downright funny, the things that happen. And if we can add a measure of lightness to the journey, it's got amazing healing qualities. So I've got a video for you, and I could not edit any of it out because it is so perfect for us this morning as an illustration of someone aging consciously and creatively and with grace and great expression. Her name is Mary Maxwell. And at the time this video was filmed, she was a relatively new client of the company called Home Instead Senior Care. Have you ever heard of Home Instead? It's a really wonderful organization. She was a new client, and she was invited to do the invocation at a Home Instead Caregiver of the Year Awards dinner. And so this is Mary Maxwell.
So let us pray. God our Father, you know all that Home Instead believes in and strives for. And we ask your blessing on the Home Instead family, the management, the staff, the caregivers, and the clients. We are grateful for the way that everyone here tonight contributes to the success of the mission of Home Instead. And we ask you to continue to bless them and this food which we are about to receive. Amen. Sorry, God. As long as I have the microphone. There are a few things I forgot to mention. First of all, just to introduce myself a little. Over the years, I've noticed that the two things most people want to know about you are the two things they're far too polite to ask. So let's get that out of the way. I'm 72 years old. And I weigh 145 pounds. As you know, we seniors are sometimes not very likable, let alone lovable. So, Lord, could you please continue to keep the people of Home Instead patient and aware of why we are the way we are? And Lord, please remind them that the thing about old age is that you don't get a chance to practice. This is the first time I've ever been old. And it just sort of crept up on me. There were signs. Random hair growth, that's special. Particularly that first time you go to brush a hair off your lapel and discover it's attached to your chin. You turn your left turn signal on in the morning and leave it on all day. Non-life-threatening skin growths large enough to name after deceased pets and relatives begin to appear. And neck tissue seems to develop a life of its own. Last November, I was afraid to leave the house Thanksgiving week. Aren't you quick? You do strange things as you age, like driving up to a curbside mailbox and ordering a cheeseburger and fries. And Lord, I know you're aware that one Sunday at church I put my Dillard's bill in the collection basket by mistake. And last Easter, after services at St. Cecilia's Cathedral here in Omaha, my husband stopped to talk to a friend, and I went on out and got in the car to go home. Gentleman sitting behind the wheel said, "Oh, are you going home with me?" And I said, "Oh, Archbishop, I'm so sorry." I won't even mention driving into the wrong end of the car wash. People get so excited when you do that. I don't know why the lady in the other car was screaming like that. I was just as surprised to see her as she was to see me. I also won't mention discovering that you're wearing mismatched earrings and going home to change them and ending up wearing the other mismatched pair. And you know, Lord, that it's hard for old people to exercise. I did try to jog once, but it makes the wine just jump right out of your glass. Well, Lord, you understand seniors and their care, and so does Home Instead. And I have used before a poem I found in a local retirement home newsletter that I have always thought spoke volumes about Home Instead. Blessed are they who understand my faltering step and shaking hand. Blessed are they who know my ears today must strain to catch the things they say. Blessed are they who seem to know that my eyes are dim and my wits are slow. Blessed are they who looked away when I spilled the coffee at table today. Blessed are they with a cheery smile who take the time to chat for a while. Blessed are they who know the ways to bring back memories of yesterday's. Blessed are they who make it known I'm loved, respected, and not alone. Just like you, to us, it's personal. That's Home Instead, Lord. Bless them all. And at the end of the evening, please help me find my car in the parking lot. Amen.
Oh, God bless Mary Maxwell. 72 is the new 60, right? And God bless every one of you who is living a conscious spiritual life, endeavoring to use what is in your life to just take a closer walk with Spirit. What's guaranteed as a result is richer living. That's the result. So we're going to close with some affirmations. Please say after me, as I grow older, my life is a full-on expression of Spirit. I am sourced by passion and infinite possibility. I live out loud as a light of God. And my life works better all the time. And so it is. Namaste. Thank you. Yeah. I love Mary Maxwell. Oh, my goodness. All right. So we're going to head into the sharing of our tithes and offerings in just a few minutes. But first, I want to bring up, this is a new segment we began last month on the final Sunday of the month. And that is what we're calling a leadership council moment. A moment with one of our leadership council members who are working diligently, daily, weekly, and monthly on your behalf to ensure the health and the furtherance of this Center for Spiritual Living and its work in the world. This month's representative is our Leadership Council Vice President, who wrote the article in the newsletter this month. Would you please welcome to the platform Theo Ann Burns?
First of all, I would like to thank Reverend Doug for that message. I am going to try to have a better attitude about bursitis and arthritis. Even a sense of humor about it, okay? Anyway, Leadership Council, first of all, I want to tell you that I feel privileged that I am on that council. Now, a lot of people, you talk to them about being on the council or talk about it, and they just go, you know? And let me tell you, it's a great, great experience, and this is going to tie into everything I'm going to talk about in a minute. In this institution, this organization, this wonderful center, we have three full-time employees. We have Reverend Doug, we have Mary and Lynn, and they all work really, really hard. But everything else that we do is volunteer, and volunteering is, well, I guess it's one of our tenets of our philosophy, sacred service. And it is always fun. You might get a little tired, but it's fun. So one of the ways we volunteer is Michael Shalaba has organized our community outreach volunteer. And this is wonderful because the organization for which we volunteer knows about us, you know? And we know about that organization. And what's more, you get to go there and do something they really need done. And that means you're working, you know? But you accomplish something, something good for someone else, for another organization. And the organization is always grateful. And I gotta tell you, it is a good way to get rid of the blahs. If you're feeling blah, go volunteer, for heaven's sakes, and you'll feel much better. It works every single time, and I can say that because I know I have done it. So, yay to Michael Shalaba and all the volunteer and the outreach that he does. You know? Also, yay to the Leadership Council, you know, because, well, I think Reverend Doug was a little generous, but we do work hard, you know, and we do get a lot done. But guess what? It is volunteer service. You know? And as I said, one of the tenets of our philosophy is sacred service. And you know what else? If you volunteer to run for a leadership council, you know what else happens? You get to know Reverend Doug really well, really well, and you get to know exactly what's going on in the center. And you get to be a part of following the direction that our parishioners give us. All right? And it really doesn't take that much time, but it's a good thing to do. So if by chance somebody comes and says, would you consider being on the Leadership Council? You're gonna say, yes, yes, of course, okay, yes. Okay, okay, other things that the Leadership Council is doing, you know, every couple of years we go through this thing with Reverend Doug's letter of call, that's right on, that's wonderful, that's going great. Elections are coming up for Leadership Council, so remember the big yes, okay? All right. And I just want to also thank some other volunteers, you know, who work hard. Jeannie in the kitchen, Mary, Jill, for God's sakes, Jill is one of our strongest volunteers. She's everywhere and she knows everything. Marilisa and Rebecca and everybody else that volunteers there and does such a great job. Also, Larry Martin, my gosh, he can do anything. He can decorate anything. Larry Thompson. Larry Martin was an old friend of mine. Okay. Larry Thompson, okay, he is a marvel. I'm sorry, Larry, I really do know your name, okay. All right, so thanks to them. Make me. And if you remember, you know, last year we had focus groups, and we're going to do that again. Because what you all told us in the focus group gives direction to this center. You know? And so when that comes up, it is important that you participate. You know?
We are doing that, aren't we?
Yes, we are. Okay. Anyway, I just want to thank you again for electing me to the Leadership Council. I want to encourage you all to volunteer and also, you know, thank people who you know that have worked hard and are doing stuff. Okay? Thank you. Bye-bye.
Theo, I would like to pull you aside a little later and find out this Larry Martin. Find out a little bit more about him. We'll go out for some wine and it'll be good. All right, so now we'll move in. Thank you, Theo, that was beautiful. We're gonna move into the sharing of our tithes and offerings. She mentioned sacred service as part of our spiritual practice. This is true. So is giving consciously, making this act that we are doing right here and now to give of our financial supply into these baskets, into this spiritual community that is doing good work in the world. It is transforming lives. It is working to create a world that works for everyone. And we tithe 10% of what you give here this morning to our denomination so that this work may grow around the world. We give a portion locally, as Theo mentioned, to our local partner every month. And it goes to fund this mission of inspiring conscious union with God. So I invite you to give with an attitude of gratitude, certainly, but knowing that this is the substance of God. It is infinite in its nature and origin, and you cannot outgive the original giver. And so we just do that, and we expand both the giving and the receiving, then, of this divine substance. Hold your gift somewhere near your heart. Give it a silent blessing, and then we'll send it on its way together. And so it is. Thank you. So that was Darren and then Melvin featured, and then Mike on drums and Justin on bass. Awesome. All right. So we're coming toward the end of the season for nonviolence, and we have a couple more opportunities to work with these. The slips are one thing, but what we're actually doing is releasing and embracing. We're releasing something that has hindered our greater life expression, and we embrace something that will support our greater life expression. Every week, we're encouraged to do this and to remember this every day. So I invite you to just access your purple slip first, because we always want to release first so that more space is created in us. And one of the things that can limit very much our growth spiritually as we mature at any time, really, is judgment. Judgment of ourselves especially, but judgment of others, which is always a reflection of a judgment of self. And if we can release any form of judgment today, it's going to go a long way to supporting our spiritual development. So if you would close your eyes for just a moment with me and take in a deep breath. And scan the reality of your life as it is right now. And detect if there's any form of judgment that you are entertaining or holding against yourself for something you've done or not done, said or not said, become or not become. Or holding against someone else, whether or not they are aware of it. That judgment serves as an iron hard block to your own development. See if you can access any willingness within yourself this moment to release that judgment if you've identified it. Am I willing? Am I willing to release this judgment? Or am I willing to be willing? Perhaps it's something that you've wrestled with for a while. If there's a yes to either of those kinds of question, I invite you to open your eyes and write that, whatever you're going to release, down, and then fold the paper at least once so that you never have to see it again. And you're going to take that paper at the end of the service out right outside the double doors there, or here at the exit up front, and deliver it into the red bowl back there or into Reverend Cindy's hands over here. She promises not to take it on. She will just deliver it to the bowl. And then those papers will be burned after a prayer is said by the practitioners of our Global Heart Connection who are sponsoring these activities during the season for nonviolence. And so we release that judgment, and it's done, and it's gone. And then there might be something then, some room for you to embrace forgiveness. Sometimes forgiveness has been defined as giving up one thing for another. So maybe there is forgiveness that you can embrace now for yourself or toward another. Or ask from another toward yourself. We did some work with that in the Prosperity Plus class this week. It was very powerful. Maybe you can embrace forgiveness as a path this week. And if that does, if a specific area of forgiveness is present in your awareness now, you might jot it down. Because the green slip, you keep with you this week. Just to remember, this is something that you were clear on this morning. And maybe you can continue that opening and that embrace as we go through the week. And there's some helpful hints from our Global Heart Connection on the back of that green slip. In recognition, again, of this season for nonviolence. So again, the purple slip, leave it here. Leave it in the red bowl or right here at the exit door up front. And then remember that you are releasing it and you don't have to pick it up ever again. And so we end the service with prayer, but first some announcements. I recognize that this is the first Sunday of spring and the announcements have bloomed. So here we go. As you have been aware, and many of you have been doing, even this morning I saw people bringing in books for the Global Heart Connection big book sale in April. So continue to do that, and I suspect that we can do it a little beyond today as well. We've had a change to the dates of the book sale because of life intervening among the Global Heart Connection team members. So rather than starting next Sunday, it's going to wait a Sunday. It's going to start on the 9th, and then we're going to bracket Easter. Easter's on the 16th. We're going to skip Easter and go to the 23rd. So the 9th and the 23rd, the big book sale. It's an amazing thing. So you have a few more days to bring in books if you forgot or have more that you want to give to that effort. And again, all of the proceeds from the sale go to our partner center in Nairobi, Kenya, and the work that they are doing there and at the school, the slum school in Nairobi. One more Sunday, this is it, for the book of the month called Daring Greatly. I gave a couple of messages on that book this month. It is a powerful read. And Brené Brown is a remarkable writer and researcher. It is still 20% off, no shipping and no tax in our bookstore. So again, this is your last Sunday to get that. And again, please be patient. We are still analog over there in the bookstore, so we're handwriting everything that you do since our system crashed. We're still working on that. And pray for that new system to show up soon and be exactly what we want and need. That would be terrific and wonderful. I would like to invite Jeff Ryan out of the High Watch and to the platform. A very, very special Taizé service is this week. It's coming through Vision with Jeff and a lot of us. Let's hear from it.
Good morning. So how many of you love our band Odyssey? How many of you love our fabulous singers that are usually standing right where Reverend Bob is? We have awesome, awesome, awesome talents in this community. And if you love to hear Odyssey and you love to hear our singers, this Wednesday, we have a wonderful opportunity for you here to hear 10 wonderful songs and sing along with them, four of which are brand new to our community that I am so super excited about. One of them, Teresa brought to us, called The Light That Never Fails, and that's the title of our Taizé service, is The Light That Never Fails. It's a song by Andra Day. You might know her song, Rise Up. And this is a beautiful one that Teresa has brought to us. And the whole evening, our month for April, too much there and too much here and too much here. And our theme for the month of April is transformation and evolution. And so what I know right here and right now is that everything is serving for the evolution of our soul. And that evening, Taizé, will be a transformative process where we will go from personal transformation and exploring the personal transformation and really anchoring into that and then realizing what it means to bring that personal transformation out into a global transformation. And the music is powerful, it's wonderful, the message is strong and mighty, and the process itself will change the way you see yourself and the way you see the world. So I invite you to join us on Wednesday evening for a powerful night of music, meditation, message, and candlelighting. See you Wednesday.
Thank you, Jeffrey. Yeah. That 7 o'clock service in here is preceded always by an hour of dinner and a wonderful fellowship in the great room. We call it a buck a bowl. You pay a dollar just for soup or anything else. There was pizza last week also. That was awesome. And so that is an hour of really wonderful nourishment before the service, which is also nourishment. It's a really fun Sunday. Next Sunday, we call it Friendship Sunday, and that is your opportunity, if you are here on a regular basis, or even if you're here for the very first time and are lit up by what happens here, to bring somebody with you that you want to share this community and this energy with. So it's a rich and a fun day. There's actually going to be a guest speaker. Some of you know him, Reverend Dan Jerome. He serves as one of the co-spiritual leaders at the Center for Spiritual Living on Rancho. He's going to be here for the first time next week. He's amazing, and he's funny, and you could do worse. So that's fun. We're going to have our children, special gifts for our guests, awesome fellowship, maybe some birthday cupcakes, maybe. We'll find out that later. And then a free spiritual practice workshop afterward produced by our Vision Corps. So it's a great full day showing all of the things that we provide in a spiritual community. Bring somebody, invite somebody to meet you here or whatever. It's a great Sunday for that. The workshop or the seminar, whatever you want to call it, after the service at noon is free. It's presented by our Vision Corps. Next week it will be facilitated by Sheila Callum and Ed Ryan, one of our practitioners. It's at noon in the sanctuary. It is a spiritual practice that we can do together, and then you can be encouraged to take the next 30 days and practice that on your own. It's really a powerful experience, and it's free at noon next Sunday. And then the following Wednesday, we have an annual visit generally by Anton Misurak and Laura Berryhill, these two wonderful musicians who are so grounded in spirit and in the world music tradition, and they have a special musical Wednesday evening, the first Wednesday of April. That's going to be a really wonderful experience. I invite you to come to that. It's a regular Wednesday evening service. It's no charge, really. We do have a collection time, but that's April 5th. Here's the transforming before our very eyes, Laura Hallett, soon to be minister, Reverend Laura Hallett, here to talk about classes, of which she knows something.
Thank you. And transformation and evolution. Whoa, what a topic. The way I transformed was through classes. I've spoken to this lots and lots of times, and I love our classes. I'm excited about them, and it really truly is the way that you can transform your life. So we have four fabulous classes being offered starting the second week of April. The first one is a brand new class. We've never offered it here before. It's called What is True for Me About Life's Challenges? And this is a class that was written by a minister out of California, Reverend Jane Beach. It's an amazing, amazing chance to go through and look at the issues in your life and see what is the truth behind those. And so that's being offered on Tuesday nights. We have Beyond Limits, which is our foundational class that is being also offered on Thursday nights. This is where everything starts. This is where you learn our basic principles, our core concepts, our spiritual practices, and how it all works together. That whole thing about the creative process that we talk about, you learn that in Beyond Limits. It is also the class that you need if you're going to take any other of our certificated classes. And then we have two morning classes that are being offered this time for the first time. We have the fabulous class called Edinburgh Lectures, which is based on the work of Thomas Troward. He was a mystic and a philosopher that Ernest Holmes studied when he wrote Our Philosophy Here. And so it's a great way to get a foundational look at what we believe here and where we came to believe it, how we came to believe that. And so it's a wonderful, wonderful class. It's offered on Wednesday mornings. And then, last but not least, my favorite of all time classes to teach, Meditation is More Than You Think. Meditation is More Than You Think is an 8-week exploration of about 30 different spiritual practices of meditation. We do all of my favorite ones. We do doodling, which is like, you know, my go-to thing right now. We make mala beads so that you can use those as a tool for meditation, the prayer beads that you use in your meditation practice. We take a field trip out to the labyrinth at St. Andrew's Church in Boulder City, which is an amazing place to sit and explore, as Reverend Doug talked about, walking the path. I'll teach you exactly how to do that. It's an amazing, amazing experience to do that. It's really a fun class. I see several people in here that have taken it before. I'm sure they can testify to that, right?
Yes!
And if there's enough interest in it, I will also do a nighttime session this time. Usually I do it at night in the summer, but we decided to offer it in the morning because we've had a lot of requests for morning classes. So we're going to offer it in the morning, and if there's enough people interested, I'll do it at night too. Thank you.
Great.
Oh, I'll be out at the education table. You can come talk to me.
The education table is in the lobby, so that's where you'll find Laura and all of the information, the schedule and everything, all the books that are required, all of that is out there coming up in April, just a couple weeks away. Next week, if you would like there to be anything to eat after the service, I invite you to consider bringing it, especially if your last name begins with Q, S, T, U, or Z. Boy, the first Sunday of the month is when the people with the great last names get to do it. So if it begins with those letters, or you just feel the call sometime this week or next weekend to bring something to share for our post-service gathering over there, please do bring that. If you brought anything this morning, would you raise your hand? That's wonderful. Thank you so much. I heard there's German chocolate cake. Not to get the word out, but boy, oh boy, I can't wait for that. Anyway, thank you for bringing it. We really, really appreciate it. We self-support this. It's the way it works, and the kitchen team is there to collect what is brought and then multiply it so that it feeds all of us, which is a remarkable thing. So speaking of multiplication, we have a bunny here that I would like to invite forward. Would Bunny Jeannie please come up?
What a great service it was today. I'm here to announce our Easter brunch champagne mimosa buffet. It's April 16th. We're going to have some yummy food. The kitchen staff is going to be putting together some bacon, eggs, ham, scalloped potatoes, French toast, fruit, desserts, and we will have champagne for $1, champagne mimosas. What else? Oh, the cost is $10, and it's $5 for kids, and I hope to see everybody there.
Thank you. Yeah. If you have ever been to a brunch that Jeannie has envisioned, you know that it's delicious in all the ways that word means something to you. It is remarkable. So thank you, Jeannie and staff, for making that happen. All right. Boy, that's a lot. I told you the announcements had blossomed. We won't do this every Sunday, but it's a good thing to see how many things are growing on around here. So we get to end with prayer, which is my delightful pleasure every Sunday. So would our ministry of prayer please stand and surround this magnificent congregation with your presence. Our practitioners and ministers who comprise our ministry of prayer have pledged to, have agreed to, really, pray every day. We enter into prayer where we are in our life every single day on behalf of you, this community of Center for Spiritual Living, Greater Las Vegas. If you would like us to support you specifically with prayer, the first thing you could do is go to the prayer room after the service. But if you would like ongoing specific support, write that down on the back of your connection card. There's a card you could fill out in the lobby and drop into a box there, or you can email the Ministry of Prayer. And those are addressed specifically for a couple of weeks, and we are absolutely honored to know the highest and best is happening for you always. And so we enter into prayer now. I invite you to take in a deep breath. And if it is your custom to close your eyes, you may do so now. And we allow that breath and closed eye reality to take us to a place of contemplation of a higher and greater truth that always exists, that always lives at the very center of our being, and it is the circumference of all being. It is what I call God. God is all there is. In the beginning, God created. In the beginning of what? In the beginning of time, God created the universe. Space and time coming into being at the exact same moment. The instant God knew form, it came into being. But before that first moment of time and form, God already existed. There was nothing for this universe to come from but the very substance of the Creator itself. So the universe is the body of God, the only body God has. And because the universe was created from the very substance of the One, the image and likeness of that One, it is reflective of the nature of its creator. It is expanding eternally because that is the nature of the creator. And so I recognize that that one that created everything in the beginning is perfection, and it is wholeness. It is right action. It is wisdom and light and love and vibrancy and peace, creativity, beauty and supply. And this is the image and likeness in which this universe is made. And so that is true for me. That is true for everyone present, for all who ever hear these words, because this is the truth of the universe. And yet here in this moment, we stand privileged to be aware of it, to align with it consciously, to embrace it, and then to let it live us in a greater way. And how wonderful to know that our entire journey through this life can be one of continuous expansion, continuous improvement, continuous understanding and development of the realization of this presence. And it shines itself in greater and greater ways. What a privilege to be in a community where this is so, where it is lived and reflected by people of all ages. And how wonderful to know that we can just invite it to continue living us in a greater way. And it does, by the very nature of its own being. I am so grateful to know this. I am so grateful to be this aware of the infinite principle of God, and to know that it is showing up as each one of us, individually and this community together. And so in gratitude now, I release my word into the law of creation, into the law that knows how to create anything and everything. And it is always working, and it always works. And it doesn't argue, and it doesn't deny. It just says yes. And so I release my word into that yes, knowing that it is taking shape in our experience as form, as felt knowledge right now and from this moment forward. We let go here now by saying together, and so it is. I am letting go of the things that no longer serve me. As I'm letting go, God's revealed and I am whole. I am letting go of the things that no longer serve me. As I'm letting go, God's revealed and I am whole. I am letting go of the things that no longer serve me. As I'm letting go, God's revealed.
let's finish our letting go process completely by singing I Release.
I release and I let go. I let the spirit run my life. And my heart is open wide. Yes, I'm only here for God. No more struggle, no more strife. With my faith I see the light. I am free in the spirit. Yes, I'm only here for God. I release and I let go. I let the spirit run my life. And my heart is open wide. Yes, I'm only here for God. No more struggle, no more strife. With my faith I see the light. I am free in the spirit. Yes, I'm only here for God. No more struggle, no more strife. With my faith I see the light. I am free in the spirit. Yes, I'm only here for God. Yes, I'm only here for God. Yes, I'm only here for God.
Woo! All right. So go ahead and reach out on either side of you. Make one final physical connection with someone next to you. And please say after me, something wonderful is happening as me right now. It is this thing called life. Life is in my mind. Life is in my body. Life is in everything I do. I am it. I receive it. I share it. And I accept it. Just the way that it is. And just the way that it becomes. Thank you, life.
Amen.